historic Michigan winters. I was a very young driver, and occasionally I began to speed every now and again. My parents warned me to slow down, especially in the slick environment. But in my teenage arrogance, I didn't listen. After all, what did they know? When they were young, cars didn't even have cassette players, let alone CD systems. And I'm sure the traction control in my car wasn't even a figment of their imagination. I thought I could navigate the snow, but I miscalculated. And against my better judgment, I drifted into a snowbank. Whether or not I wanted to believe it, I was stuck. Have you ever been stuck? Against your better judgment, you got yourself into a situation or merely found yourself in a bind that was totally out of your control? You can't get out of it. You can only endure it. And with God's help, we can endure every system, every snowbank, every emergency. We can endure everything that comes toward us in this life. If you understand that, then you understand the dilemma of Mary, Martha, and their brother Lazarus. Jesus had a relationship with them. More than that, he loved them. Yes, he spent time and nurtured them. The narrative explains the severity of Lazarus' injury or his illness. In great detail, it expounds that Mary and Martha sent word to Jesus in Jerusalem that their brother, the one Jesus loved, was deathly ill. It goes on further to say that upon hearing the news, Jesus stayed where he was 2 more days. It really appears that Jesus left Lazarus stuck in his own mortality, stuck in his life-threatening illness, stuck. And logic begins to step in. As we read this passage, we learn that Jesus did not move. And one can begin to think that either Jesus did not know or Jesus did not care. Yes, one can deduce that Jesus was slow to move. The magical life, being a Christian, is suddenly altered. We shouldn't experience trouble when we're in the bond of Christ, should we? We shouldn't experience sickness. We shouldn't experience distress. We shouldn't experience death in this manner. We think, if it's magic, why can't it be everlasting? Like the sun that always shines, like a poet's endless rhyme. If it's pleasing, why can't it never be leaving? Then we delve into the age-old question, why does God allow bad things to happen to good people? It's then that we learn that life is no fairy tale. We learn that all struggle in different ways. That struggle is a form of education because we learn primarily that our personalities don't prevent us from pain. That our positions with Christ don't stop the predicaments of life from coming at us head on. We learn that nothing stops us from experiencing certain pains in life. Mary and Martha wept bitter tears over the body of their brother Lazarus. And their affinity to Christ did not, cannot, and will not impede the inescapable component of struggle in our lives. And if you have not struggled this week, keep on living. If you have not struggled lately, keep on living. For we do not struggle alone. We do not struggle in vain. I think of Dr. Samson. He's slow to mention his name. We pause and we say, thank God for the life of Dr. Frederick Sampson. We love him. We pray that he has continued improved health. We count it done that God will act on his behalf because he is in the hollow of God's hand. We love Dr. Sampson the way that Jesus loved Lazarus. But it did not stop death from occurring. Didn't stop the predicament from happening to Lazarus, and it won't stop the predicaments in our lives. I wonder, why does God allow 9 believers in Charleston, South Carolina to be shut down in Brother Emmanuel? Why in the latest episode of gun violence allow 50 parishioners to be slain in 2 separate New Zealand mosques just a few days ago? It's been a while since I cried while praying, but I did on Friday. I wept tears for those who came out of the sincerity of their heart just to seek God as they knew God. It doesn't matter if we have differing faiths. I weep that someone can be fueled by xenophobia and ignorant enough to think that they have the authority to take lives that they did not give. It brings tears to my eyes that anyone could be so cold, that anyone could stop in the midst of a house of worship and kill everyone they see. And there are times like this when I really don't understand. No matter how much I pray, no matter how much I read, I just don't get it. I don't understand certain things that God allows. I don't understand certain things that God permits. I don't understand certain things that occur. Maybe I never will. I don't understand how God could allow innocent lives to be taken. And I find camaraderie with Mary and Martha in this instance. They pleaded with Christ and they shared their anger. And the flip side is God can take my anger. God can understand my frustration. God can understand my emotions because God gave them to me. And since God gave them to me, I can give them back to God freely, respectfully. Share who I am with God because God knows me best. God knows you. The humanity of Christ is apparent in the Gospel of John. In fact, this gospel makes it abundantly clear that we can't know Jesus outside of his humanity. There's a part of him that easily connects to us, to each. When we look at Mary and Martha, we can see things literarily, because this is a poetic gospel. Martha is exemplified as a worker. She shows the works that are necessary to make faith real. Commentaries have identified Mary as exhibiting true faith that would not shrink, an adoration of God in the midst of chaos. We need both faith and works. We need both Mary and Martha. However, neither of these traits console us from the outside looking in. It's only when we examine the story inside out that we see it and everything else differently. In verse 4, Jesus says that this sickness would not end in death. He doesn't speak these words to Mary and Martha. He says those words to himself. And I want to ask you a question this morning. How will we respond when God doesn't speak to our fears? When God doesn't reply to our haste? How will we respond when God uses the pain in our lives to work God's plan? The pain was the loss of a loved one. But the plan was for others to bear witness to Christ as a result of Lazarus's resuscitation. Jesus was about to perform a spectacle and a miracle, extract glory from grief and save a life. However, the story isn't about the acts of God as much as it's about the unflinching trust required from God's servants. God's servants are not just Mary and Martha. God's servants are not just Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. God's servants are you and me. For in the midst of the chaos of this world, in the midst of the madness that we see, in the midst of the emergencies that we face, we'll need some unflinching trust. So shall we trust in the Lord this morning? Shall we trust in the God that we can't see to deal with the problems we can see? Shall we trust in a God, or shall we rely on our own efforts? Shall we trust in a God, or shall we face the problems by ourselves? Wise among us would trust in God. The wise among us would seek the face of God in the midst of the tragedies. The wise among us would seek the face of God every day. God grants. I know you can trust God when everything is going smoothly, but can you trust God when you're at your wit's end? I know you can trust God when you have money in the bank and friends downtown and a healthy reputation, but can you trust God when all you have is the promise that God made declaring his everlasting presence? In this instance, God is saying, I may take you through what appears to be a death. You may lose your reputation, you may be stretched to the limit of your comfort zone, but I have not left you to death as much as I have brought you through death. It doesn't mean that you won't be upset, but it absolutely means that you must keep your faith. Your faith shall be tested. A faith that cannot be tested cannot be trusted. Oh, for a faith that will not shrink. Doesn't mean that you won't be upset, but it means that you must keep your faith in the midst of your anger. It doesn't shield you from tragedy, but it keeps you through it. And it delivers you safely past it. God has a track record of keeping me. God has a track record of keeping you. God has a track record of keeping us through dangers seen and unseen. The question is whether I can trust a God that I can't trace, whether I can believe in a God that I don't always understand. The blood that Jesus shed for me way back on Calvary, the blood that gives me strength from day to day, shall never lose its power. I may lose my life, but it shall never lose its power. I may lose my money, but it shall never lose its power. I may lose what I think I need to survive, but it shall never lose its power. How do I know? Because I've been where Lazarus was. I've been so sick with meningitis that I was comatose. The days turned into weeks. The weeks turned into a month, and didn't look too good for me. But God, I was on death's door, but God. No matter what you're going through in your life, no matter what challenges you face, no matter what circumstances appear in front of you, but handle it with God. You can bear it with God. You can outlive it. You can outlast it because of God. God has kept you, and God will comfort us and keep us through sickness, shelter us during the storm. And you know, that's reason to remain righteous. That's reason to seek to do right by God and by your neighbor. That's reason to do right by yourself. That's reason to look at yourself in the mirror every day and say, I have a life worth living. That's a reason to raise your hands and give God praise. In this scripture, we see the miraculous power of God coupled with compassionate care of God. Yes, the Lord weeps at the destruction that is often committed in God's name. The Lord weeps. The Lord weeps at the loss of life. The Lord weeps at the patriarchal sexism that forces women to be silent and ushers them to the figurative recesses of the church. The Lord weeps at the lack of humanity in the face of the homeless and the intolerance of those who are differently abled. The Lord weeps when we display the worst of our character and only display the worst of our character at the worst times. The Lord weeps at intolerance. The Lord weeps at bigotry. The Lord weeps at racism. However, the Lord meets those tragedies with tears, but he doesn't stop there. He hears the valid fears of his servants, but he doesn't stop there. He greets our human frailty with his divine power and leaves us better than we came. I'm telling you, the Lord will act. The Lord will act on your behalf. The Lord will act to forward God's cause. The Lord will act to prove God's love for us. But let me get back to my story of when I was a young driver. And I veered off the road into a snowbank. I was there for maybe 5 minutes. I had flown into the snowbank and I was absolutely afraid. And there were cars that were inching by me, but not one of them stopped. You know how long 5 minutes is when you're cold and alone? And this was before the rise of cell phones. So I was cold, lonely, and stuck. And then an old steady tow truck came my way. And it looked familiar because I had passed this snow truck or this tow truck about a mile back. I said, man, this guy's going very, very slowly. I know I can go faster than he's going. He's inching along, but I know I can do much faster than this man is going. And I did, and I flew into the snowbank. But here comes this old steady tow truck. Inching along, here comes this old steady tow truck. He saw me, but I didn't see him. The driver said to himself, that man is going to crash pretty soon, and I'll be there to help him out when he does. The driver slowed down, and he hooked his tool to my axle, and he did for me what I couldn't do for myself. You never realize how fragmented you were until you've been made whole. You never know how lost you are until you've been found. And he reached down, and he grabbed me out of my situation, and he helped me get on my way with no charge. Family, that's what the Lord is doing for us today. He sees that we're going to crash. And instead of passing by as though he doesn't see us, he connects to us. And he gets himself in position to ease our pain with his purpose. He gets himself in a position to rescue us when we could not rescue ourselves. He lightens the load by and by. And he pulls us out of predicament time and again. That's what God is doing for us today. And that is reason